So we're gonna start this session with a recitation by Asad Baig, who's one of our student leaders at NYU, and if you remember, he introduced the conference for us yesterday.
Assalamu alaikum. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة عالم الغيب والشهادة هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر سبحان الله سبحان الله عما يشركون هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور له الأسماء الحسنى يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم صدق الله العظيم
Bismillah. So this session is called Conversations, and it builds up off of a program that we started at the IC, or we had a pilot program for, and we're looking at launch, inshallah, in the coming months at the IC. The IC is the Islamic Center at NYU, for those who aren't familiar with it. That's what we kind of call it as a nickname here. That is called Conversations. And what we're looking to do as we institutionalize and go further in our community development is to begin to focus on creating more entry points for sub-communities within our broader minority community of Muslims. Converts have a very interesting experience in the Muslim community. And one of the things that I had done when we were trying to establish this program is I met with probably about 30 or 40 different individuals who are part of our community here at the IC who had embraced Islam at a later point in their life just to hear their story. And more often than not, when we hear the story of somebody who converts to Islam, we listen to it in the frame of, tell us why you became Muslim. We hear about this impassioned story where it gives us a real solid boost in our own faith, and it lasts with us for a few days, but we never hear about what was kind of hard in the process. We never really hear about what was difficult in the transition to the Muslim community, why perhaps it wasn't the easiest decision, and how we potentially made it a little bit harder. And we feel as if that's a story that needs to start to be heard. Because many times, whether we're conscious of it or not, we alienate and ostracize many individuals in our community. And converts are just one of many of these subgroups, and it's not to distinguish and alienate and further cause isolation, which one could argue I'm probably doing by putting a panel of converts on stage and letting you stare at them. But, you know, whatever, I'm not a convert. And so the way this is going to work, because we have half of the audience on the stage, instead of giving them the opportunity to speak, and share their story, is going to be kind of a more guided question format. And what would be ideal is that if you all have questions and want to participate in the discussion, you can either write your questions down and send them up to me, or there's two microphones in the front of the room. You can come and ask your questions there. And you can do that at any point in time, right? But we want this to be a very open and frank discussion, because we have to internally start to deal with some of these things so that, again, we can build healthier and more vibrant communities, not just places that are built on very cursory interactions, very superficial relationships, but where we actually understand the lived experience of the other, even if the other happens to be a Muslim. And so we need for you all to be engaging here as well. Otherwise, it's just going to be me asking questions, and that's going to be really boring, right? Because I have a very monotonous voice, and, you know, nobody really likes to hear me talk anyway. So what we're going to start off with, and if you're on the webcast, you can tweet questions via Twitter, and we'll try to get those answered as well. Use the hashtag ICNYU2011. You know, there's only like 4 people who've been doing this, by the way, right? There's like 600 people bought tickets to this conference, and we have people like all over the world watching this thing, but nobody is using this Twitter thing. So please, just somebody send a question via Twitter. It'll make us all very happy, and we'll make lots of dua for you.
Even if you're in the audience,
just do it. Just do it so we'll feel good about ourselves. So we're going to start off just starting from Ray, who's sitting to my right. They're going to introduce themselves in just a minute or two so you guys can get a feel for them. I know we talked about this before, but what's going to be really important for you all on the stage in engaging this audience is that you're very open and honest in what you're saying, right? It's not like a free-for-all or no-holds-bar type thing, but don't hold back and let things be very, very open so that we can, in a very healthy and safe forum, be critical of ourselves so that we can start to move forward on some of the issues that we have in front of us. You know what I mean? Right. I'm going to say you know what I mean a lot, too. There's certain things that I say a lot, and like a lot. Right. Yeah. Fadl, go ahead, please.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Anybody who knows me knows that I like to say something before I say something. So before I tell my story about my accepting Islam, I want to acknowledge, first of all, that even though that we're a panel of people who accepted Islam, that I want to recognize that a lot of the things that we have gone through and the stories that we'll tell are going to be very similar to those people who lived in Islam their entire lives, who were born Muslims. And I say that because I get people who come to me who are born Muslims and those who have accepted Islam as adults or as children or what have you, and they all come sharing the same stories. And they all come talking about the same things, about, you know, being distant from Islam or not practicing Islam and then growing near it, or transitioning closer, deeper to Allah, practicing Islam more, but their families don't practice Islam, and their families, they can get a lot of conflict with them, or they're practicing Islam in a way that's different from, let's say, my country or my culture, and they say, I want to stick with Quran and Sunnah, and this I don't know from Quran and Sunnah. I don't know a hadith that says you do this, and I don't know anything in the Quran that says you do that, and they get in trouble with their family. So I just want to acknowledge that, you know, inshallah ta'ala, that inshallah that will fuel some of your questions too, because I imagine that many of you will echo some of the experiences that we have, even though we accepted Islam and we weren't born into Islam. So with that said, just very briefly, my accepting Islam was really a lifelong journey. I grew up in a family that is right now half Muslim and half Christian. But during the time of... the Nation of Islam, most of my family was Muslim. And the people who are Christians now used to be in the Nation of Islam. And when that fell apart, a lot of people went back to the church. But what you have is the rest of my family going to a Quran and a Sunnah, practicing Sunni Islam. So my entire life I've been exposed to Islam. Now with that said, the type of Islam I was exposed to was not necessarily the best example of Islam. And what do I mean by that? I mean that where I'm from, your first exposure to Islam is in a gang. And that was my first exposure to Islam. I grew up as a Salam. And as a Salam, we used to fight with the Abdullahs, right? And we would fight with them all the time. And that was how we knew each other. It was really, oh, this is your family and this is your family. And we would rob each other, beat each other up, you know, do all of these crazy things. But really under this banner of Islam, we're Muslims. And we take on these Muslims' names. None of us pray to Salah. Right, nobody prayed, nobody did any of that kind of stuff. But this was the example of Islam that I had, I want to say, you know, deep until maybe I was a teenager. And it wasn't until then I started to meet other Muslims who were a little bit older, who were actually practicing Islam, and really encouraging me toward becoming a better person. And it was really through that that I really started to question a lot of my own beliefs. I was a kid, I went to Catholic school all the way up until high school, and then I went to public school. But you know, it was really early on that the seeds of Islam had been planted in me. Why? Because I experienced Islam through the gangs, through the fighting, through the crime, but then I met Muslims who were saying that this isn't really what you're supposed to be doing. This isn't the path you're supposed to take. This isn't what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects from you. You know, how can you be a better man? And it wasn't until later on in my life that actually during my undergrad years, I really drawn a little bit nearer to Islam. And in graduate school, I've been Muslim for a few years now, and I accepted Islam during graduate school. And so it was a major shift between people who had known me throughout that process, because halfway through I became Muslim. So a lot of the things, going out to drink, partying, doing all of this clubbing and having social gatherings, like that, a lot of that stuff I stopped doing. And I want to say accepting Islam, you know, at that stage in my life was something I didn't see coming. What I did see was that my life was slowly starting to change. For one reason or another, I decided, you know, I'm going to stop drinking. I think I drink a little bit too much. I hang out and I party a little bit too much. I think my friends are into some things that I'm starting to grow out of. And slowly but surely, I found myself letting people go. Spending less time with people, socializing in very different ways, and I had no idea really why. Which is interesting, because at that point where I was living while I was going to graduate school, I actually lived across the street from a masjid. So I could hear the adhan every time I was in my house doing something wrong. And it used to make me feel so guilty, because I knew people were doing something right. Right? And that's what drew me to Islam. Knowing that people were doing something right. And that I myself had the power to do that. So I think that's it. I'm going to stop now. Thank you. Man.
So if you guys take like 2 minutes to introduce yourselves. Right? I know, man. It's okay. You know? I used to be in a gang. I'm not going to say anything. I already got shakes of hate mad at me for saying the drive-by thing. I got yeah, right. Pow pow.
Matrix.
Hello.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Will Caldwell. I'm a master's student in religious studies here at NYU. I converted about 5 years ago when I was a senior in college. I was actually at Hebrew University in Jerusalem studying Hebrew when I decided to convert. There's always a question in my mind as to exactly how that happened. I'm not too sure. The best answer I've ever heard to, like, why did you convert, was given by Sheikh Abdul Hakim Marad. And he said it's simply because, you know, Allah is very generous, He's very kind. And I think that's always exactly the right answer. I can often tell you about the circumstances around why I converted, what was going on in my life around that time, but as to why or exactly how, I'm often left without words. So for now, I think I'll just leave it at that until we get into more of the details and the circumstances of how we converted. Thanks.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. My name is Gareth Bryant. Contrary to what you see on the label, Musa Bryant. Musa is what people call me. Gareth is my name. So I became Muslim when I was 15. And this reversion happened in a time when in my life when I had a lot of low self-esteem issues. My father had died when I was 8. And there were a lot of things that happened in my home life that were volatile, that as a young person without a father, I didn't have the tools to deal with it. And one of the things that I was looking for was, validation just of my own existence because of certain things that were happening. And one thing that I can say is that, I can honestly say, thinking back, is that Allah always protected me just by virtue of the fact that He made me Muslim. And one of the ways that He chose to protect me is that I never had any like atheistic concept. I always believed in the oneness of a God. It's just that I didn't know how to please Him or worship Him properly. And I grew up in a Christian household, but many of the things referring to the theology of Christianity, I saw as like utter nonsense. And I was always like a free thinker, and like, mashallah, I was a free thinker. So I would ask different questions like on a theological level, and people were never able to give me the answers that I wanted or needed. They weren't able to give me the right answers, flat out, because there are no right answers. So that was one of the main things that propelled, it served as a catalyst for me to become Muslim. And there were a lot of things that happened in my life, like during like high school, my high school years, because unfortunately I wasn't very religious. And there were a lot of things that happened in my life that made me really, really reflect about which directions in my life that I should take. Like, for example, like being shot at. Like, once you're shot at, like, that's something that really makes you think, like, I need to really, like, go back to the drawing board and, like, think this thing over. So that happened to me a couple of times, and mashallah, it hasn't happened since, so I must be doing something right. So without further ado, I'm going to pass the mic to my brother Jay.
My name is Jay Dabi. I became Muslim 4 years ago. Came from a Hindu background, Hindu family. Grew up trying to find God and trying to figure out religion, and I was trying to practice Hinduism as best as I could, and then I couldn't find the answers from my family or by reading books. It was very confusing for me. So then I hopped on a plane and went to India for the first time so I could see it firsthand, and I came back even more lost. So then I started reading. Well, my background is I'm a DJ and a music producer. So I used to go to this record store since I was like 14 years old, and the guys that run the record store are Muslim. I didn't know that. So then I started telling him, yeah, I just came back from India and I'm lost, and you know. So he's like, oh, here's a Quran. I was like, wow. So he gave me a Quran, and then the Quran is sitting on my table. I didn't really open it. It was on the side of the table. And I knew some of the rules, like, you know, keep it at higher level and don't put it at low. So I would leave it there. And then one of my friends who's not a Muslim came over one day. He's like, yo, bro, what you doing with that book? And I'm like, what do you mean? He goes, don't read that book. People who read that book convert, man. So, so from then, I was like, wow, what's so powerful about this book? So I started reading it. And slowly and surely, and I mean, I'm going to fast forward because you ask a convert how he converted, and we'll just talk your ear off, I'm telling you. So fast forward, I came across the ICNYU podcasts, and then I noticed that instead of being listening to music on my iPod, I would be listening to Khalid all the time. Like, I would listen to his podcast, and then one day I had the courage to just email him and say, I don't know why I'm feeling these things, I just want to meet up with you one day. We finally, after months of trying to fit into a schedule, I met him at the ICNYU Old Center, and I just took my shahada right there. We'll get into more in the future.
So really, really quick, when Jay came to take his shahada at the IC, I actually used to listen to Jay's CDs when I was growing up. he used to mix Bollywood songs, and his name was Little J. And I had his CDs. He was like Bollywood's finest, Little J, whatever.
New York's finest.
And he came to take his shahada, and after he was done, I called up my sister, and I was like, I just gave Little J his shahada. Like crazy. Inshallah. Sorry, Lisa Fulton.
Hi, assalamu alaikum. My name is Lisa. I'm a senior here at NYU. Hopefully, inshallah, graduating in May. Similarly to Jay, I was raised in a, I guess, Hindu background. My mom's really Jain, but like, you know, it's like all the same thing eventually. Yeah, my parents weren't really practicing. My mom's my extended family on both sides was more practicing, so I wasn't raised in like a religious household. But there was this stigma, I guess, of Islam and like Muslims that was just kind of like not spoken about but understood. And so, I just grew up with this concept that like Islam was just something that was like in the world, and I should just kind of try to stay away from it. So Islam is really the last thing that I thought I would ever be involved with. I was in high school when I started to question my religion. I didn't really understand Hinduism and what it was about, and so, like Jay, I tried to like figure things out, but essentially I couldn't find the answers that I was looking for. And then when I got to college, I was even more confused, and I joined our gospel choir. And so I was this Hindu girl singing about Jesus in the gospel choir for a while. And that confused people. And then throughout that process, about halfway through my sophomore year, I had been like researching things online, and I found Islam, and I was intrigued. And I learned more and more about it, and alhamdulillah, I took my shahada halfway through my sophomore year. And for a little bit, I was a Muslim girl singing in the gospel choir. But yeah, so I'll talk more about that later, inshallah.
Bismillah. Assalamu alaikum. My name's Peter. Hey, how's it going? I reverted to Islam, alhamdulillah, when I was 15. It was about a month away from my 16th birthday and a few days before Christmas. I wasn't really, like Lisa, I wasn't really raised in a religious household. My mom's side is Jewish, my dad's side is Catholic, but neither of my parents practice, and we were basically raised with, like, holiday swear your religion, so like Christmas, that's, you know, Hanukkah, spend the dreidel. And that was pretty much it. So I was always kind of curious about religion and about God, and, you know, growing up, you know, if I asked my parents, like, what religion am I? They'd be like, oh, you're Jewish and Christian. And, you know, it wasn't until I got older that I was like, that doesn't make any sense. So I was like, can't be both. So I started, like, thinking, like, which one am I? Am I both, or can you be both? So I started kind of looking into those two religions a little bit more deeply. And I kind of did find a lot of similarities between them. What I was really looking for was, I was trying to figure out, I believed in Jesus. I preferred the Jewish, version of God, without the Trinity, and I was trying to figure out how those two fit together. I'm like, it's got to work somehow, and you know, I looked at, you know, I watched like History Channel shows of like who is the real Jesus and things like that, and no, then they always kind of showed him he's always more Jewish, so I was like, how does this? There's definitely some kind of way that like Judaism and Christianity fit together that can like work, I'm inshallah going to be a high school history teacher one day, inshallah, make dua, if I can find a job. But when I was in ninth grade, I was really into history, and I remember looking in the textbook, and I saw like Judaism, Christianity, and Islam like kind of grouped together, and I was like, huh, that's interesting. there's a third one. So one day I just was on Google, and I literally ISLAM, and the first thing that came up had a keyword. One of the keywords under it was like Allah, Muhammad, Islam, whatever, and it said Jesus, and I was like, whoa, what's this about? So I clicked it, and I started reading articles on Jesus and Islam, and I was like, oh, there it is, this is it. This is like, and it was the religion of Jesus and his companions, and I was like, this is something. So I kept learning for several months, and about a year, and alhamdulillah, I ended up taking my shahada at the end of that, during the next year, alhamdulillah.
Mm-hmm. As-salamu alaykum.
Jazakum Allah khair. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to speak with you all today. Peter, apparently you and I are the same person. Jewish and Christian household.
Let's switch.
Yes, but the inverse. So my father Jewish, my mother Christian, which makes me more Christian than Jewish. But I won't go into that. Yes, no birthright trip, that's right. What to say? I mean, I converted in 2006. This is my sophomore year at Fordham University, which is it's a Catholic university. The gist of it is that before I went to college, I took a year off, and I decided I was going to look for the meaning of life. It's a pretty tall order, I know, but I still haven't managed to find it. Actually, that's not true, I have, and I'll tell you what it is in a minute, inshallah. Your suspense is killing you, I'm sure. So, I decided I was going to look for the meaning of life, and I went backpacking, I traveled, I worked, I read lots of books, mostly dealing with Eastern philosophy, Taoism, Buddhism. I read the Vedas, but I don't recall them that well. I went to college, and I guess just to echo Peter's sentiments, the thing about growing up in a Catholic Jewish household is that you sort of walk away with the impression that religion is good, but it doesn't really matter which one you pick. So that was my approach. I figured, hey, I'm at a Catholic university, I might as well just go and speak to these priests, because in my quest for meaning, I sought out the elders. I spoke to people who had lots of experience, who could shed a little insight on what I was going through. And so I really, mashallah, genuinely loved them and benefited from their company. But it didn't work out. Through what ultimately turned out to be a fortunate series of events, I did not get baptized, did not get confirmed. And then later, I was hanging out with a couple of friends, and these guys were Muslim. I mean, like the remarkable thing is that they party, right? But but there's still something about them and the way that they treated each other that I thought was different, and the fact that they were so insightful in certain respects, and the way that they could like uncover, read between the lines, if you will. Really, it begged the question, you know, what are they reading? So on to the meaning of life. I converted. The end of the story is that I converted, alhamdulillah, in 2006, as I told you. But the meaning of life, I learned. See, prior to my understanding of the meaning of life, I thought that once you reach this epiphany, you just practically, like, you know, turn into this cloud of dust. And, I mean, metaphorically speaking, right? But you'd reach this higher state of consciousness, and this was my preconceived notion of enlightenment. And I remember I was in Morocco studying abroad my junior year, and this gentleman, also by the name of Khalid, came to our school to talk to us about Islam. And he mentioned the hadith, the ayat of the Quran, I have not created man and jinn except to worship me. I was like, subhanAllah, that's the meaning of life. And in contrast to what I previously thought, when you learn the meaning of life, you don't just sort of, I don't know, turn into a cloud of dust. I can't really think of a more sophisticated way to put it, but you don't do that, you work. I mean, when you learn the meaning of your existence, you work. So I'm not going to say any more. I'll pass it on to Shazir.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. I actually became Muslim in 1992, so I might be the older member of this illustrious, mashallah, committee of fellow epiphany experiencers. I actually got involved in hip hop culture in like 1983. I was young. I was like 11. And I started DJing when I was 14, so I think Jay, you and I have the same life. And at that time, as you know, there was much more hip in Islam than there was hop. I mean, sorry, in rap music, there was much more hip than there is hop now. And I was exposed to a lot of the cultural elements of the 80s hip-hop scene as well as the early 90s hip-hop scene. I tell people my first sheikh was Rakim. and KRS-One and Chuck D and Paris, X-Clan, you know, A Tribe, the Jungle Brothers, Zulu Nation. That was the whole kind of vibe that I came out of. And then as a DJ, especially if you had the Technique 1200s, right, with a Gemini mixer, you had to have two copies at least of every record. So I would constantly hear these records like 1,000 times over, right? All praise be to Allah, and that's a blessing. Poor righteous teachers, Assalamu alaikum, wa alaikum assalam, the universal greeting of the people of our kind. These were actually songs that were out there, right? And so we were like, yo, what are these dudes talking about? And then having serious theological questions about Christianity since I was young. Not really being able to believe that God was white in the suburbs, black in the hood, and Latino, another part of town, you know, all these multicolored gods. So I was a DJ for a brother who actually was a member of kind of a pseudo-Islamic cult. We used to talk about Islam all the time. And then I was involved in a gang, the Bloods, Pomona 456 Piru, as Khaled has, you know, mentioned. But one thing that Khaled doesn't know, and I'm going to keep another 2 minutes, is that the guy that I was involved in the drive-bys with was a Muslim. Who I went back later on to meet after I became Muslim, and he had already died, right? So we used to smoke weed together, and he would tell me, like, Jesus ain't God, man. And then I was like, what are you talking about? And then that's how really I started to actually have a conversation with someone. I'm not encouraging anyone to do that. But that's how I started to hear about Islam and actually be able to talk to someone. And I was like, get out of here, man. Jesus is God, man. Mm. He's like, no, here, hit this. Jesus ain't God. Then I made actually 3 records. You're not going to find them anymore. And I was experiencing some fame. We're DJing, but empty. I was very empty inside. And I started searching. I found a copy of the Quran in the library. I started reading it in the restroom because I was scared that my mother, you know, don't mess with your mama, man, would kill me. And then I went, and now here's the secret about me in New York that's going to tell you something. I went to a flea market, like a swap meet. I don't know if you have swap meets on the East Coast. And there was this guy with his big turban and this white dress, his big beard. So I went up to him. I was wearing all red. I was flamed up trying to catch the girls. And I used to sell my mixtapes actually there back in the days. Remember mixtapes, Red Alert and Marley Marl and them? So we had mixtapes. So I saw, not this whack mixtape. These guys couldn't mix malts to Dairy Queen now. But we went to this guy and I saw him and I was like, man, why do you look like this in Oklahoma? And then there was this real beautiful writing. He was selling incense and oils, and he was from Marcy, lived in Oklahoma. So then I was like, yo, what's up, man? I thought he was a foreigner, and he was like, yo, what's up? What's cracking? I was like, man. I was like, how did you learn how to talk like that? He said, no, I'm American. I'm from Brooklyn. There you go. I'm from Marcy, Fort Greene, and Marcy. And I moved here. And then he actually was the person I took shahada with. Mm. Now, what's interesting as I finish is I was wild. I mean, you can tell. I was wild. Fortitude aside, I was wild. And he said, man, I used to watch you for like 3 years sell your tapes, and I used to pray that Allah will guide you, man. Mm-hmm. And so that's really how it happened. Alhamdulillah, may Allah reward him. He's from here, from Marcy.
As-salamu alaykum wa
rahmatullah.
I think I just forgot everything I was going to tell you, so I'm going to wing it. But my name is Khaled Latif. I'm the executive director of the Islamic Center at NYU. No, I'm just kidding. My name is Cyrus McGoldrick, and I work at the Council on American Islamic Relations in New York. And you know, my experience might be different than a lot of people on this panel. My family is actually primarily Christian and Muslim. My father is Irish Catholic. My mother immigrated here from Iran and was raised Muslim. And, you know, we were raised, I think for them, we were kind of Christian by default. I think the urge was to assimilate. And I realized that, you know, for them, the real love was in worship, was in worshiping God. You know, the important thing was believing in God. I remember when, I must have been in middle school and high school, and I used to be so mad, and I would be so mad I had to go to church, and I would complain, and they would be like, well, if you find a Buddhist temple somewhere in Pennsylvania, then we'll go. And, I mean, that wasn't really a reality in Hicksville, Pennsylvania. But I think for me, you know, growing up with such trust in all faith, you know, and trust in God, you know, when I got older, when I was a teenager, you know, I lost faith, and I thought I lost faith in God, and I thought I didn't believe in God. And I realized, the older I got, that that wasn't the case, you know, that I believed in truth, and I believed in a truth even, and I believed in God, I just didn't know what it was. And this will probably be a story for another question, but actually my... the first time I really expected that Islam could be for me, or that I actually even had that inclination, because no one in my family ever pressed anything on us. In my family, we had Christians and Jews and Muslims and Baha'is and Zoroastrians all in my house praying at the same time. And there was never anything weird about that. Nobody ever pressed any beliefs on anyone else. The first time that anyone ever told me to convert to Islam was he was an alcoholic 5%er. And it really struck me, you know, because at the same time he was doing what he was doing, but I really saw the importance of the discipline, you know, that, and I think first for me, before coming into Islam, I really had to have a respect, first a respect, and then a sincere belief that Islam as a discipline was a way of life that could make us all better people. And at that point, there was a point, I remember I woke up, it was the first of Ramadan. I've been studying for months, maybe years, I've been studying Islam, but I remember I woke up on the first of Ramadan, probably 2007. I just started fasting, I just knew it. That was it. Alhamdulillah. Anything else you want to know? Well, we'll talk about it later, inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
My name's Whitney Terrell, and I'm from Minneapolis, Minnesota. Woo! I moved to New York about 2.5 years ago to work in the financial industry. But my experience coming into Islam was kind of interesting because when I was 5 years old, my dad started getting involved in the nation. So since around that time, like, you know, we cut pork out of our diet. And my mom was still Christian, but, you know, I still was exposed to Islamic-like principles. And I think the respect that I had for Islam or Islamic-like institutions came from the discipline that the men had. There was this, like, remarkable transformation in the community because, you know, people just had, our community just kind of had this, you know, facelift almost through the nation for all of its good and whatever. And I even had like a Muslim name at that time. So I think later on, even though I continued to practice Christianity, studying the Bible really deeply in middle school, there's this point that I remember taking on a personal motto, which was to seek truth, beauty, and goodness in all things in middle school. And then I started having a lot of questions because we had Bible study in school. And my questions about the Trinity weren't being answered. I wanted to know, where can I find the word Trinity in the Bible? Like, I just want to see the word. And just something simple like that. And I thought, there's this one gospel song actually that stood out for me that basically said, like, God will do what he said he will do. He's not a man that he will lie. He will come through. And I was like, this is a gospel song that you're singing. Like, this doesn't make sense. And there were a number of times in church, like, I tried, like, even when things didn't make sense, I would try to go and, like, sit and listen. And I just wanted to get up and, like, walk out. I was like, this just does not make sense to me. The choir's, like, praising. Sometimes you say God, sometimes you say Jesus. And so eventually I got to a point where I just felt, like, overwhelmingly compelled to that there was just one God, and I just was kind of like, I'm like a no-nonsense person. Like, once I accept something as a truth, like, I just, you know, that's it, you know, like, alhamdulillah, like, I called one of my friends, and her family was really influential. In high school, I was like the Christian student on the Muslim Student Association in high school because we were really cool. So I was like, you know what? I love you, so let's go. Like, let's check it out. So, you know, like the Miss competition? So they had the first one in Maryland, like, while we were in high school. So we did that, and, you know, I was sitting there, like, basically learning about Islam, like, through her family, and they were a model example to me. Like, I felt like there was some kind of like peace in their family that it was just amazing. It was beautiful, just how they treated each other, prayer, just very loving family, period. And to this day, like, when I go to Maryland, like, it's extremely emotional to see them.
Well, now it's hard to start. Well, hello. My name is Megan Putney. I'm the program director of the Muslim Consultative Network. So I come from a Republican family. Let me start off with that. And so I grew up, with my Republican family. And yes, hello, Muhammad. I hear him yelling my name up there. So I went to South Korea to teach English, and I had the fortune to meet 8 Pakistanis and 1 Sudanese that ended up being really close friends to mine. And it was a phenomenal experience. We would all have tea together, and just the way to describe these young women and men was that, you know, whenever I'd walk by, they'd come out in the hallway and be like, Megan, come have tea with us, you know, come have tea. And I just always felt included. They always made me feel included. And I remember that that's what really got me, like, interested in learning, because I was like, these people are phenomenal, subhanAllah. And it got me to, you know, crack open the Quran and start learning about the deen. And alhamdulillah, you know, I said my shahada 5 years ago tomorrow. I said my shahada actually on a PIA flight from Karachi to Lahore, but I said it to myself, and so I redid it again in February. So that was a little story.
Make it.
I'm gonna take it.
We used to fly PIA when I was younger, and it really makes you remember God when you fly. So, right now is kind of where our conversations usually end when we're dealing with people who have converted to Islam. We do a panel, we call it From Darkness to Light, come hear the stories of conversion, all these kind of things, but then we don't ever take it a step forward. Everybody feels really good right now, right? Like, you feel it inside, you know, you have this just really cozy, warm feeling. But then we never take responsibility for what comes after that conversion story. We don't really ever hear what it feels like in terms of the transition, how it's hard to give up habits and lifestyle decisions. We don't really feel like, you know, what it feels like in the same sense, even if there's parallel situations being born in a Muslim family, it's very different. Companionship, how do I find a spouse? People tell me that it's great that I converted, and then they never talk to me a day after that in the masjid. I'm never invited to people's homes, these kinds of things. It's all real. And so what we want to kind of do before we take questions from you all, you know, I'm sorry. You're a big man too, so if you want to say something. Ibrahim used to be a linebacker. And you know, I'll put it out there. Ibrahim used to be a linebacker at the University of Rhode Island, right? So I have all these large men who I'm always like telling to do things, and I feel like one day one of them's just gonna knock me out really badly. But I'll give you an example, right? And this is an example, and I want you to think about it. When Ibrahim was speaking, and he said that he is a child of converts, right? Before that, how many of you assumed that he was a convert? Right? There wasn't only that many people, you're lying. And you don't have to raise your hand, but I want you to think about it. Because we're stuck in these frames that don't really allow for us to grow. This man was born into a Muslim family, but because he's black, many of us would not ever think that. And then that has an effect on his psyche, as well as the overall psyches of everyone sitting here, because we utilize that same mind in dealing with him as we deal with them. And again, I'm apologetic for pointing fingers at you, but you know I love you, right? You know, you people over here, wow. Right? So if you guys could start, maybe some of you can kind of let us know, when was the time when you felt, you know, most isolated by the Muslim community? What was an experience you had where you just felt very alone, having engaged the Muslim community, and you were left kind of in this place where it was like, I didn't know Muslims did this to Muslims?
Yeah, definitely, most definitely. One of the things that happened to me, like from, I would say, when I was still in high school, like I said, even though I became Muslim in high school, when I became Muslim in the ninth grade, I wasn't very religious. So I was kind of like a knucklehead, and like there was three things that I never thought I would be able to give up, ever. Women, weed, and partying. And that was like a real big struggle for me. And like I would say from like 2000 to 2003, Allah gave me the strength and the courage to give up those things, right? But what ended up happening is that I had gotten involved into a particular community, the Salafi community particularly. And I remember that I changed in a lot of good ways, and then I also changed in a lot of negative ways. And when I started to realize that, like kind of like many of the negative things that basically almost like possessing me, and I would like name call people like heretic and innovator and all this type of stuff, and I was just swept up in this whole movement of making people feel less because they don't agree with your views. And Allah had to, not had, but He did. Allah humbled me to a great extent. And I'm grateful for that because it made me reflect on how wrong I was. And when I began to realize that and I began to change for the better, people who were in my circles, they began to turn their backs on me because I stopped being that person who was the name caller, who was saying, oh, you're not good enough because of this, you're not good enough because of that. And there were a lot of things, other things that happened, like for example, like I said, my name is Gareth Bryan, right? And I didn't change my name when I became Muslim. And when I learned that as long as your name doesn't have a negative meaning, there's no need for you to change it, I expressed that deeply among people, and I received a lot of resentment for it. I remember when I first became Muslim, the whole thing about like wearing a kufi and a thobe and shawakamis, all that type of stuff. I would wear it sometimes, not wear it sometimes, and I came to the decision that I'm not going to wear those things anymore because it's not Islamically required. When I started to do that, people, like I said, people in my inner circle would like say things like I'm a deviant or I'm an innovator, to the extent where there was a brother in a particular community who actually encouraged people to not send taslim upon me when they see me, or to give me the cold shoulder when they see me. And to the extent where I remember, it was a Juma khutbah, and this brother, he gave a khutbah called The Etiquettes of the Masjid. And one of the things he said that whenever a person comes to the masjid, they shouldn't dress like they're going to a party, right? So this person basically gave the impression that if you're not dressing like this, the way you're dressing is not Islamically valid, or you're automatically doing something that's obscene or haram. And I remember looking at people, and they looked directly at me, because I was the only person who didn't have a thobe, who didn't have a kufi, and that was further resentment that people felt towards me. So I have a lot of personal experience with people like basically boycotting you or treating you bad, and that really hurt the most because non-Muslims had never treated me that way, but Muslims did. So that makes me like extra sensitive to never, be foolish enough to condemn someone because of their, whatever their level of religiosity is, because true guidance comes from Allah and not ourselves. And all of us have flaws, all of us have faults, just like the Prophet said, all of the son of Adam are sinful, and the best of the sinful are those who make repentance. And that really sticks with me. And also what he said is that the Muslim is one who protects the people from his negative statements and actions. And a lot of times we oppress people with our ignorance, and we also oppress people with our knowledge. So I always try my best to protect people from my negative statements and my negative actions, and I hope that everyone else can do the same.
Does anybody else want to answer this question?
About isolation?
Yeah, Father.
So like I said, I converted to Islam in 2006, and in 2006 I walked away from Islam because I remember feeling this deep, deep sense of isolation and not understanding what was going on with me. I mean, I had found religion and so many of my problems were supposed to be solved, and yet, you know, I mean, what I experienced, you probably, if you haven't heard it, you might hear from some other panel members, but the things that new Muslims go through, I'll let other people touch on it. But it basically just got to the point where I sought out the advice of a sheikh, you know, a bona fide sheikh. He studied, and I won't say where, and I won't say where I spoke to him. But I told him, I said, "Sheikh, I'm so sad. What do I do?" And right after yelling at someone for sleeping in the masjid, he turned to me and he said, "Sadness is the result of sinful action." So I said, forget this. Right? I said, you know, forget this.
That's not what you said.
How are you going to call me out like that, man? No, but I mean, what did I leave my life for? You know, why did I leave friends and a support network for this? To be told that I'm a sinner before I'm even told, you know, anything of relative use. I mean, the first week, I mean, at first, I you know, when you're a Muslim, when you're a brand new Muslim, you're like, you know, people say you're like a newborn baby, you're impressionable, perhaps in the same way. So I took what people said to heart, naturally. I mean, they were Muslim, they would know what they were talking about, right? And when I was told that I was, you know, I had just converted, I was having trouble waking up at 5 o'clock in the morning to pray Fajr, and when I was told that I was sinful, then, you know, naturally I believed it. So, like Garrett said, I mean, information, knowledge, rather, becomes a burden on people if you don't have the wisdom in knowing when to dispense it. So people overburdened me. I mean, people didn't talk to me so much as they gave me piles and piles of books, pamphlets that were in really poor English, and just like, and this I had traded for, you know, the homily, which I, you know, I found spiritually very moving. And anyway, I'll just wrap it up by saying a lot of the ideas espoused in these books were really crazy. I mean, they were not common sense at all. And they, when people would come into my room and then say, "Hey, I heard you became Muslim. What's this?" They'd say, "Oh," it actually ended some friendships. I mean, right then and there. So
just to also, you know, I'm gonna try not to interject, but I talk a lot. As much as it creates an opportunity for us to, you know, find laughter and kind of that understanding when somebody's talking, and I'm not saying for people not to laugh, you definitely should. This is something he actually went through, and that's what I want you to focus on, right? When he's trying to learn Islam, people threw stacks of books at him that he couldn't really kind of get through. That was his pathway into the deen. So as much as it puts us in a place where we're like, yeah, we can relate to the pamphlets that, you know, have no sensibility and they're English and they're an archaic language, whatever, right? This guy, Jonathan, you know, Allah preserve him, was a great man. We didn't help educate him. Like, we made those pamphlets, we wrote those books and we translated them. And we never thought from the perspective, maybe there's going to be a young white guy from Boston who's going to read this one day.
Boston.
Massachusetts. Whatever.
Yes, thank you.
We could do a New York City roll call so that Massachusetts is totally blown out the water. But we won't do that. But that's what I'm saying, right? Like, as we go through this, like, listen to what's being said and, like, actually listen to it. You know, that was his path to education. And that's really bad of us. And we have to start thinking about those things. You want to say something, Will, on this question?
Yeah. I almost feel bad. I have a feeling most people didn't know that this is what they were getting into when they came. So my apologies in advance. But I think Yahya is exactly right when he said that new converts are like babies, because in terms of what we understand and what we're susceptible to, that's exactly right. We've sort of absorbed everything. What's said and what's left unsaid, what's done subconsciously. So when it comes to very overt actions, that's compounded 10 or 100-fold, who knows. For me, I felt alienated within 2 weeks of converting. So when I got cut off from them, that was a big deal. And the reason I got cut off is it became apparent very quickly that the guy who was sort of taking the lead and teaching me how to pray, teaching me some basic Arabic, it became clear that he was interested in more than a friendship, more than a student-teacher relationship. And when I sort of tried to push back on that, and he wouldn't accept that, what ended up happening is he sort of poisoned the well for me. Mashallah, my friends were very supportive. But in terms of understanding what I had just done in converting to Islam, there was no one there who was capable of understanding. And the point of me telling you this is that set the trajectory for the next 2 to 3 years of my life. The reason I stayed, I guess I could say, the reason I decided to remain Muslim was almost out of resentment for the people who didn't help me. It wasn't until I came here to NYU that I actually found a healthy community and started to sort of rehabilitate my relationship with Islam from one that was motivated by resentment and anger to one that was actually based on healthy relationships with people. The role models that I met here completely changed the course of my life. And if there's one thing I could say to all of you and to everybody on this panel, it would be that role models are so important to someone who is in every sense, regarding the deen, a baby. We need to absorb all of the positive energy that we can. And so having a community that provides that is absolutely important, because I can tell you that it can ruin your life for quite a long time if you don't have that. So, thank you.
So, Jay, and then Peter, and then we'll kind of move on in the discussion.
I think one of the most, when you're the most sensitive or the most fragile is right after you take your shahada, because it feels like a 1,000-pound weight is off your shoulders and you feel amazing, like you want to run through the street saying, "I'm Muslim," but after that, you're kind of lost. I would have to, go to Google to figure out how to pray or finding different rulings. And then on top of that, born and raised in America, we're grown up with the way Americans have grown up. There's alcohol, I'm a DJ, I'm in clubs 4 nights a week. You guys are born Muslim, a lot of you. How many of you can go into a masjid and tell their mom, how do I stop drinking? So imagine us converts, how do we make this transition now? We know it's bad, and we know we want to get to that point, but the hardest part is, who do you talk to? And I had nobody to talk to. I kind of had to talk to Allah and say, "Allah, guide me away from you. You guided me to Islam, help me away from all this bad stuff." And alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah happened. But I think right after we take our shahada is when we need to, side story, I go into the masjid, and if I tell them I'm a convert, they'll take me to the corner, oh brother, sit down, tell me, you know, and they make dua for me like I have special powers. I don't have special powers, you know? I need help from you. So, I mean, you know, if you see a convert, help him out.
So very negative experiences, and I just kind of wanted to bring up, I mean, alhamdulillah, I don't think I can remember I had any really seriously negative experiences with Muslims, like directly negative, but I think a problem, an issue that's an issue for all converts, I guess, is that even if there's not a specifically negative issue, it's not that Muslims are doing something bad, it's that they're not doing anything. Because it's really lonely as a new Muslim, especially in the beginning. And I think like the most obvious time is like suhoor, like, you know, like waking up and it's like your whole family's asleep and you're like in the kitchen making noise and like eating like yogurt and like Cheerios or something for suhoor and just like, oh, it's kind of dark out. I don't know. So, you know, I mean, although I'm, you know, I'm sure a lot of people also have that same experience, but you know, it has a much more of an effect on you as a revert. I mean, not even that it was such a negative thing, but it was you feel lonely. And you know, everyone around you, your family and stuff, and your friends, and most people don't have a Muslim community or a group of Muslims that they can even relate to. You know, if you're raised in Islam, you have your family, at least, you know, that there's more Muslims around you. There's someone who, okay, at least this person like has a similar like view of reality as me. But like, at least for myself, like I felt like I was in the twilight zone half the time, you know, because everyone sees the world very differently than I do, and it's troubling, because then you're like, well, maybe there's something wrong with me. Why am I the only one who feels this way? How come nobody else agrees with me? So inshallah, like, you know, I think I'm sure we'll talk more about this, but we really do need to create more resources for new Muslims. And even like you were saying about like going to the sheikh, like, you know, with drinking and stuff like that, like I think we talked about this in some of the other panels about the disconnect between like the scholars and the community and how we need to have a better like communication with our imams and stuff. And we all know about that, but for reverts, I think, at least for myself, I kind of assumed that I was the only one who didn't like, I'm like, oh, these people are all Muslim. They all know exactly like who to go to and where to answer these questions, and I'm the only one who doesn't know what to go. So I'll just figure it out on my own because I don't want to bother anybody.
So you guys referenced, a couple of you, a need for certain resources for new Muslims. I mean, what specific resources do you think would be valuable that are established and forged within the Muslim community? Aside from educational institutions, so we see a tendency for resources and services to primarily be, this is how we teach you how to pray, this is the fundamentals of your faith, which are essential and they're valuable, but moving beyond that, what are other things that you think would be helpful for you all?
I can say that the internet is both a blessing and a curse in terms of resources, because you can find anything there that you need, and you can learn quite a bit. So in that sense, it's very useful. But I think something very valuable is the ability to be able to learn from a human being. I learned to pray from instructions I got on the internet, and that was incredibly helpful to me, but at the same time, having a person there who can show you what to do, who can guide you, who can make corrections, humanizes the entire process of learning, and I think especially in those first few months, first years, that's incredibly important, because more than anything, I mean, we need to learn, but we also need to have that sense of community as well, and learning from people provides both of those.
I also think it's important that people have a good social circle. So while the deen is like obviously, you know, foremost, it's really challenging to leave everything that you were before. So obviously, you know, I'm not going to totally like change my personality, but sometimes your families think that you've like betrayed them. So they, in so many ways, like it's important for us to remind our parents, like we're still your child, we're still your sister or our families, you know, we're still your relative. But then at the same time, like we need affirmation from in a different way that gives us the courage to interact with them and to share our faith. So sometimes just doing simple things, fun things with your friends who are converts, it normalizes Islam. Like everything is not about going to the masjid, or you know, it's obviously like you can go to dinner with your friends, you can go shopping, like it just you don't give up everything when you become a Muslim. So just offering something simple, like inviting someone to your home, like that's a really important space, especially if you don't do anything outside of the masjid. Like, I've learned so much through living with other Muslims that I can't learn through reading a book, for example. So just share your home with people, share your family.
So one last question from my end, and then we'll open it to the floor so Ibrahim doesn't get me down. How has it been in terms of finding companionship? Because more often than not, you know, I deal with a lot of people whose families are just not approving of who they want to spend their life with, who they want to get married to, etc. And it doesn't really seem like there's a consciousness that when you leave your own kid hanging, you're also leaving somebody else's kid hanging. And what that might mean in the absence of a family structure or a support system and some of the other resources that you all have been talking about. So in marriage in specific, and also just companionship in general, what has that been like for you all?
I guess I'll start if nobody else wants to take the mic. One of the most difficult things to give up, as just to echo what Gareth said, was companionship. I mean, that relationship, the relationship that I had before I became Muslim, that was nourishing. You know, I don't need to tell you all what relationships are like. But it was something that was very dear to me, and that was definitely the most difficult thing to go without in these past, 6 years? But alhamdulillah, the advantage has been that I've had to search for meaning in myself and in other things, and I've had to find patience and happiness and contentment and strength and all of that by myself, which has been completely worthwhile. But to answer your question, I mean, I've experienced, I think most people have. I think you've met someone that's interested you, and it doesn't work out because one side, the parents on one side or the other don't approve, because you don't come from a particular village in a particular country, or you know. And it was pretty difficult at first, but I mean, I'm grateful that I didn't get stuck with in-laws like that. To be perfectly honest, thank God I didn't have to marry into a family that would never look at me as good enough or deficient in some way. So while I have experienced it. I guess, alhamdulillah, I've found some sort of resolution. I've found some sort of peace with that. I'm not saying it's as simple. I'm not saying it's simple or easy, but I don't know. I don't really know how to conclude.
I have to say something. Sorry.
Yeah. I didn't mean like that.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm sorry. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Ladies first. Ladies first.
So my family is half Jain, half Hindu, and everyone has married somebody of the same religion, same color, and So my family, I'm actually the oldest girl, the oldest child, I guess, of all my cousins and everyone. So I have a lot of pressure from my family in terms of marriage and like marrying a good Hindu boy, because my extended family as of right now still has no idea that I'm Muslim. My immediate family knows, and it's still very difficult with them. So I actually have yet to tell my extended family, which is also a struggle that I'm somehow going to try to work out, inshallah, very soon. But it's difficult when I go home and I see my extended family, and I have uncles telling me, you know, talking about my wedding already, and the guy that I'm going to marry, and I don't know who he is, and like, who are you talking about? Like, and they're pressuring me into this marriage that they think is going to happen, and I feel terrible because I feel like I'm crushing a dream that they have had and have planned for me. As like the role model for the rest of my cousins that are all younger than me, looking up to me. And my mom, who is the most important person in my life, consistently reminds me of this. And she tells me, you know, you're the oldest, you're supposed to be the role model for the rest of your cousins. And now, you know, look, what are they gonna do when they see this? How is everybody gonna react? And, you know, just for my mom alone, who's like the most important person in my life, it's very difficult to hear that. And to have her feel like I have betrayed her, or that I don't love her because I've, you know, converted to Islam. But I would say, in terms of my extended family trying to figure out my future for me, or having this like dream of what it would be, and not having the courage or like the ability to tell them yet that, you know, that's not really how it's gonna go, is very difficult. And you know, inshallah, may Allah give me the strength to overcome that.
Amen.
Accept it.
Ibrahim, you want to ask your question, man?
So my question is really simple, and different people have answered parts of it. For those of you that have made the transition, and lived very different lifestyles, particularly those that were like rowdier. you know who you are. I'm very curious specifically. Now, a lot of y'all have been very good about, you talk about what you talk about, and then you speak in these lovely platitudes. I'm not interested in the lovely platitudes. I'm actually interested in specifically the conversations that happened between those friends that you had to let go. And how was that? What did that, like, what happened there? And how do you reconcile that? And maybe even some of the new ways that you had to create friendships, and how did that develop, inshallah?
So just to let everybody know, we're going to extend the session a little bit, so please bear with us, because the conversations are important.
With my friends, they saw a gradual change. Like, they would ask me to go out, and I'd be like, nah, not tonight. And I kind of like, I didn't mean to blow them off. I just wasn't interested. And then I just wouldn't want to hang out with them. And nothing against them. I just don't want to be in those type of environments. I just saw that it was, you know, it's not worth it not to be there. So slowly and surely, they came. I got married last year. So they came. I got married to an Egyptian girl. So they came to the wedding, and they were like, okay, so, you know, in the Hindu ceremony, they have a jhan, where they have like a horse, and we go out and start dancing in the streets. So they were ready to, they're like, oh, when is that going to happen? So I was like, oh, I think I should just tell them. I never told them I was Muslim. So then I just told them, I said, oh, by the way, guys, I'm Muslim, huh? But then I really wanted them to know that it wasn't because of marriage. Because a lot of people think that when a convert becomes a Muslim, it's because of marriage. And a lot of times, not the case. Becoming Muslim comes first, and then you want to find yourself a nice Muslim wife or husband, right? So, and also in my family, it was the hardest thing for me to tell them. I mean, I hid it. And then I was about to get married soon, so I wanted to tell them before I got married. So I knew they were going to find out anyway, but I don't want them to resent my wife, saying, oh, look, she turned my son into a Muslim. So I told them before I got married, and but that's a whole different, that was a hard thing. My extended family, like hers, doesn't know. But now I changed my profile on Facebook to Islam, so I think they're going to find out. So when I told my friends that I'm Muslim, it's funny, I would think that they would bombard me with questions. No one's ever brought it up, and they've never asked me anything. And I feel like now I'm the other. There's like a wall now. It's not like we used to be so tight. I mean, flying to different cities, hanging out for years and years, and now it's not there anymore. I don't know why. I'm the same guy. I'm just not drinking with you. I'm not partying with you, but I'm the same guy. But I don't know. It's weird. Mm-hmm.
So we had a couple of questions written down. Is somebody trying to talk? Who's trying to talk? Oh, my bad, man. Good. Sorry, please.
Referring to Ibrahim's question, I would say referring to, like, letting friends go. I had, like, people kind of viewed me as being kind of hypocritical. Because, like I said, when I became Muslim, I was really young. I was, like, the whole party scene, girl scene, like, drug scene, whatever. And, like, I would kind of, like, try to, like, basically, one of the things that I would try to do is, like, I would try to be, like, partially Muslim one day, and, like, on the weekend, I'd be, like, a weekend warrior or something like that, right? You know what I'm saying? Like, I just had this whole routine. Like, I go to Webster Hall, catch a movie, go to Webster Hall, all types of crazy stuff, right? But then, like, people... Too much info. But, yeah. So... So when I used to like dip and dab, so to speak, people would like actually call me on it. Like, wait a minute, are you supposed to be Muslim? And you doing this and you doing that? And that was another humbling experience. Like, I had to make a decision. Like, who was I going to be? Like, what type of life was I going to lead? And that really like stopped me in my tracks, because I had to say, like, listen. I'm at a crossroads right now, and I don't want to be a hypocrite. Like, I don't want to be those, because, you know, like, when you read stories about, like, the hypocrites, and, like, they're going to be in a fight forever because they pretend to be Muslim, and for whatever reason, their heart is no true belief, and the characteristics. And I started to fit some of those characteristics, like, perfectly. And I'm saying to myself, damn, like, I don't want to be that person, right? So that was, like, a transition for me. But at the same time, people thought that, oh, well, you just changing because this and that, and... Like, it was really difficult to, like, break away from those negative aspects and even some of those people. Like, there's a lot of people who don't speak to me because I don't party or I don't do this or I don't do that. But one of the good things is that if you display integrity, Allah will do either one of two things. He will either make you a good example for those people, or he'll just replace those people with better people. So I had the opportunity to... be somewhat of a good example for others, and the people who couldn't accept the fact that I was improving, Allah replaced those with better people, and some of those people are right here on this panel, so mashallah for that.
Together.
Can I?
Man, you don't ever talk for 2 seconds.
Can I add something? Yeah.
No, I just wanted to say something, because sometimes these stories can be very negative. What? But no, alhamdulillah, you know, I come from a community, like I said earlier, you know, where most of the people were Muslim. So I didn't have the same reception when I accepted Islam, and I would come home and talk to the people about the fact that I was Muslim. And I'm saying this to say to you all that we have to appreciate the power of Islam and the respect that people have for Islam, that even in the lifestyles that they're leading, the way that they look to us, right, to us as examples, right? So we have to be mindful of that, inshallah ta'ala, that we sometimes have to brace ourselves for being rejected, but again, like you said, that we have to be mindful that there are people who are now starting to look toward us as leaders. So inshallah, that was 2 seconds.
So I was about to pledge Alpha Phi Alpha and cross the burning sands and go to Morehouse, if you can believe it or not. Yeah, it's a long story, because Spellman was there. But I converted to Islam the night before I became Muslim. You know, I was high, was with my boys. But before I became Muslim, I'd say I started reading the Quran. I had this girlfriend, and her uncle was actually Muslim. It's crazy. The guy that did the drive-by was Muslim. The girl's uncle were Muslims. Mm-hmm. Allah guides us in very different fashions, mm-hmm. really. I mean, you know, you never know where the blessing is. So she would actually tell me, because I stopped eating pork, right? You know, like Big Daddy Kane said, no pork on my forest, strictly fish on my dish. You know? So I was exposed. No, I mean, but we have to be honest. We have to respect the power of popular culture to shape constructs in the mind. I'm being funny, but I'm being serious as cancer too. That really, you have to understand the power of popular culture, right? And that there was a generation of early night, I call them the Das Effects generation, of a liege of brothers and sisters that became Muslim in the 90s because of hip hop. And it's a reality, right? So I became Muslim, but before I became Muslim, because I was listening to these songs, I was like, well, we're not supposed to eat pork. So I said, I'm gonna stop eating pork. And then alcohol, stop drinking the 30 ounces. And then it was the big battle was that chronic marijuana. So I basically said, you know, this is the last real hurdle, and then the girls, like I think everybody else said. So alhamdulillah, I stopped smoking weed. It was like 6 months before I became Muslim. Actually, I thought I was Muslim. I didn't know about Shahada. I didn't know about five prayers. I just read the Quran. I said, I believe in it. So I tell people, I took Shahada in the restroom, man. And then this girl that I was messing with, she was telling me, you're not a Muslim. And I was like, what do you mean I'm not a Muslim? And she's like, well, my uncle is a Muslim. First of all, white boys can't be Muslims. Secondly, Muslims don't drink and smoke weed, and they ain't got girlfriends. So like, she actually, even though she was not a Muslim, she was like crucial in helping me realize like, this is something real. So I slowly stopped doing those things. Then I became Muslim in November of 92, alhamdulillah. But I was still DJing, and I'm sure you can relate. I had like 5,000 records, grocery crates full of records, and that's how I made my livelihood. And one thing I want to encourage you about new Muslims, and I don't want to take too much time from the brothers and sisters here, but in the fifth chapter of the Quran, and even in the seventh chapter of the Quran, and in the books of fiqh, you find that the new Muslims are given a lot of leeway. So, for example, if you go to penal law in classical books, like let's say the Maliki school, so the concept of apostasy, you'll find that Khalil, he says, إِلَّا مَنْ أَسْلَمَ حَدِثًا. He says, except for the one who just became Muslim. Zina, they say, except for the one who just became Muslim. Apostasy, except for the one who just became Muslim. Thievery, except for the one who just became Muslim. Why? Because they haven't had enough time to, as she talked about, simply living around Muslims has such an important impact on you, right? So one thing I would, and even in the fifth chapter of the Quran, we talk about the creedal problems that we run in sometimes, getting called, you know, non-Muslims and fasiqs and people of bid'ah and all that stuff that we had to go through. In the fifth chapter of the Quran, just reflect on the disciples of Christ when they ask him a question which the Salafis and the Ash'aris and the Sufis and even the Catholics agree is kufr. And that is, they ask him, can God send a table from the heavens? It is theologically unacceptable for a believer to ask, can God do something? Because God is qadir ala kulli shay. But did Isa turn to the Hawariyin and say, you're kufar? Did he expel them from Islam? And Imam al-Qurtubi says that Isa's response to them was predicated on the fact that they just became Muslim. They hadn't had time to understand the upper echelons of Aqidah. The same thing in the seventh chapter of the Quran, the followers of Moses ask him, اِجْعَلَنَا إِلَهًا كَمَا لَهُمْ آلِهَةً. Can you make for us idols like the homies in Egypt had? Moses didn't say to them, you're kufar and you're not from Ahl Sunnah. He said, innakum qawmun tajhalun. You're ignorant people. So the ulama said, here, people should be given time, man, to understand the deen. So I was DJing, and that was when Dre's first, you know, when Snoop came out. And I remember I was DJing at a university, and I was playing, you know, Girls Ain't Nothing, you know that one. I was playing that song, and it wasn't girls. And then it was time for Maghrib. And I was like, man, how the heck am I playing this song and I'm praying Maghrib? So one thing we should respect is the ability for Islam to slowly transform people. And really the best change is a change itself, you know, initiated and comes through introspection. So I remember I was DJing, and literally I was like crying, because like, man, how, like what the brother was saying, I don't want to be a hypocrite. I'm playing Dre, you know, not censored Dre, with young Snoop, and these people out here getting down, you cutting it up, boy, that white boy got skills and everything. And then it's time for Salah, and I go pray Maghrib. I'm like, I gotta play the extended remix, because I gotta go make Salah, right? And Allah says, Salah keeps away from what? from Fahsha Munkar. And so after that, I was like, you know what, I'm through with this, man.
Like, I'm playing country now.
I can't destroy, you know, I can't destroy families with this. So, but it took me almost a year to stop that stuff. Yeah. And also, the second week after I became Muslim, my best friend got shot in the back of the head with a Glock 9 from a Gray Street crypt. So my friends were like, yo, you gotta come. They didn't know I was Muslim either, like the marriage situation. They were like, no, you gotta come to the funeral. So of course I ran into some of our Salafi brethren who were like, you can't go to the church and you'll become a kafir if you go to the church. And then I ran into the kind of the liberal guys and they were like, you can even go worship in the church. And I just, but then I asked my heart and I was like, you know, that's my boy. Like, he got shot. So I went to the funeral, and then being in a gang, what happens after one of the homies gets smoked? We finna roll out on some fools. So they were like, look, so you got the car, I had a car. They were like, we'll go steal the car. You come over, we got the straps, we need to blast on these fools. Which means, sorry, you know, we need to get together and shoot somebody. So I was there, and I was like, my heart was just like pounding, right? And I had no real Muslim, I didn't have a Muslim I could go to the cha-cha in the mosque and be like, yo, I'm finna roll up on this fool, yo. Can you, like, help me, right? So what happened was, I went, who do you think I went to? The brother from where? From Marcy. I went straight to that brother, and I said, look, man, I'm about to blow up. My best friend, I saw, like, all this plastic surgery in his face, and, you know, it was J-Dog, that was my boy, and instinctively, I need to do something, but religiously, I know I'm not supposed to do it. And he was like, look, no, you gotta sit down, we gotta talk this out. So one thing that helped me when I converted though is that a lot of the bloods in my community, all of us became Muslim around an eight month period. One of my best friends became Muslim. So what we did is we had like this little convert. Till now, it's not Imam Suhaib Webb. They're like, man, ain't Imam Suhaib Webb, man. Right? But those brothers are the brothers that, you know, I can trust. But luckily we had that resource. And I'll be honest, when I left Oklahoma and went to MCA in California, which is one of the biggest masjids in America, I'm lonely there now. Because I don't have that element anymore of those guys that I became Muslim with and that relationship where if unfortunately I had to go blast on someone, which I hope I won't, I could actually find someone that would even be able to understand and tell me, you can't shoot somebody, man. You know, you're a Muslim now. So I think one thing that we said is that we're like babies, but at the same time, we're like teenagers the first day of high school. Socially, we are inept, we're terrified, we're scared that we're not gonna be accepted by the community. Everybody says takbir, but when we say, can I marry your daughter, they say peace. Right? And that's... They say, you know, when you want to marry their daughter, idhab anta wa rabbuka faqatila inna ha'una qa'idun. When you ask him about that, they say, as like the Israelites said to Moses, you know, go and fight with your Lord, we'll watch you. And until now, the African-American brothers who convert to Islam are facing an unbelievable difficulty with racism that we don't want to talk about in our community, man. And even white people, when we find our community acts like white people, but when Ken want to marry their daughter, they don't like white people. It's just, it gets really hard for us and confusing. And that's something that's not talked about.
Yes, subhanAllah. So we had, just because I made a Twitter plea before, I got like 25 Twitter questions now. This one's from somebody whose Twitter handle is NYCOZZ. NYC Oz. What is one thing that you think non-converts, I've never heard that before. What is one thing that you think, you know, it's interesting how people identify themselves as they go through conversations like this, right? It's really interesting, and I'm not going to waste time kind of talking out my thoughts because they're not really coherent on this right now. But really, like, have you ever called yourself a non-convert? You know what I'm saying? Right? And look at what compelled you to call yourself a non-convert, NYCOZZ. So, what is one thing that you think non-converts take for granted the most about Islam?
Yeah, please. I got this one.
I got one. Oh, yeah.
I got this one.
Well, no, I mean, I could give you like 30 examples, but in the sake of time, I'm going to give you one. So, Eid. I'm going to tell you right now, Eid.
And there's several reasons, but the one I really want to emphasize to all of you is that, like, you all have Eid, and you've had Eid your whole life, and you grew up with Eid, alhamdulillah. And the thing is that you usually have families to go home to when you have Eid, and you usually have a huge feast when you have Eid, and you usually, you know, give gifts, and you have these attaches that you've had and these since you were a kid. And that's not necessarily the case for us, brothers and sisters at this table. You know, Eid can, for me, alhamdulillah, I've always been blessed with people saying, Megan, you want to come to our house for Eid? Megan, come over, we'll serve you lamb. And you know, and I'll graciously eat it. And but my point is that some brothers and sisters don't have that. They don't have that. And I want to tell you one thing that was just so powerful for me. One sister, this last Eid, you know, I know her, but I don't know her that well. And she gave me a little gift, and I don't know how to tell you how profound that little gift really meant to me. So just to tell you again, like, Muslims, we take for granted Eid and all the things that come with it. So just remember that.
Right.
So I guess my one response to that is knowledge. The one thing that I get questioned about a lot, well, called on a lot, is knowledge. Whenever I talk to a Muslim who was born into Islam, and they know that I'm a convert, and we talk about anything that has to do with Islam, the assumption is that I don't know, or that I don't know better than them. And I think that is really insulting, and I get that a lot whenever I say something to someone and they find out, they don't do that until they find out that I converted to Islam. And that's one thing that, because I found that a lot of people are actually very ignorant of Islam and don't study and learn as much as they should, and they take for granted that what they know culturally is actually Islam. And in talking to them, saying that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this, or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this, is different from saying, but this is what my uncle did, or my grandma did, or my father did, or how my mother taught me how to pray. MashaAllah. I mean, and it's astounding how frequently you find it. Alhamdulillah, on a good note, I had a sister actually call me one night after berating me, after spending 45 minutes telling me about how I was a convert and how I didn't know better than her. She actually went into her imam and proposed a question to him as if her friend, you know, this, I got a friend who said, right? And he said exactly what I said to her. And he said, and you need to tell your friend, da 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 da, and she is this and she is that. And if your friend believes this, then she needs to come to class. I mean, his response to her was so poignant that she actually called me back to apologize and said, you know what, I'm sorry. You know, I took for granted that you didn't know this or you didn't know that. And my imam said exactly what you said. And use the same evidence that you use. So we need to be mindful of that number one, study Islam, and number two, don't take for granted that someone knows or does not know something based upon how long they've been Muslim, where they grew up, or what have you. We got to be mindful of that.
There we go. Sheikh Saheb, and then Musa.
Just one thing I wanted to add is also, you got to start supplicating on the minbar for your converts, and their parents, and their friends, and their families. I mean, it's one thing when you're already socially lonely, but then when you go to the, I mean, I remember once I prayed Taraweeh behind this brother, and I could understand Arabic then. And he went into like this hour-long spill about the Americans. This is, of course, pre-9/11. And, you know, sending stones on their houses and tidal waves and fire and all that. And I was like, I will have that home, you know, or guide them, right? So I think sometimes when you supplicate, I remember once a brother told me to do it, so I did it. And I say, you know, may Allah bless the families of the converts. May Allah make the converts a source of guidance for their parents and their friends. And the sister came and she was crying. And her brother told me that. And she's like, man, this is the first time anyone ever prayed for us, man. Like, I actually feel like I'm part of the sermon. Whereas I've constantly been kind of like having all these problems and issues, and the community doesn't even pray for me. So I think that it goes back to what he was saying. Everyone asks us to pray for them. But we're like, man, we have more skeletons than the Smithsonian. And then, you know, just praying for the converts and their parents asking them, you know, not are your mother and father Muslim, when did they convert? That drives me crazy, right? But just how are your parents doing? You know, how is your family? But supplicating really on the minbar and halaqat and stuff, I think is very crucial for us.
So we're gonna do Musa and then Marlene, and then we might have to wrap up. And no, I'm sorry, and Whitney, yeah, and Lisa. One thing you gotta realize at the Islamic Center at NYU, I don't really get to make any decisions, right? Even though I'm the executive director of the center, I just get told all the time how things go. So, you know, basically what I said, we could just forget. And what we're gonna actually do is we'll go Musa and Whitney and Lisa and then Marlene. So if you wanna sit for a second, because I'm sorry. Yeah.
One of the things that I know for a fact that a lot of people who are born Muslim take for granted is the fact that they have Muslim parents. Like, this is a blessing from Allah that a lot of you, like, completely disregard. Like, I hear people, they complain about their parents. Oh, my parents are this, my parents are that. Like, are you nuts? Like, Allah gave you parents that are upon Tawheed. Yeah. And no matter what their flaws are, when they die, you have the opportunity to ask Allah to forgive them.
Yes, probably.
I don't have that opportunity. My father died before I became Muslim. And I have to psychologically and emotionally prepare for the fact that it's very likely that my mother will die as a non-Muslim. Mm. And when we hear the stories of the Prophet about his parents not dying upon Tawheed and by his uncle who he cared for so much, and even his uncle who tried to kill him, Abu Lahab, he loved his family. And these people died upon shirk and kufr, and there was nothing he could do about it. And even the verse where Allah says, you cannot guide who you love. Right? And that's something heavy to swallow, to know that you can't ask Allah for forgiveness for a person after they die. That's heartbreaking. And when I hear people who have parents who are born Muslim, don't you ever take that for granted. Don't you ever be ungrateful for having Muslim parents. That is one of the single most blessings that Allah has ever given to you. Honor that and respect that always.
Whitney.
It's not just like your parents, right? Just think of your siblings. You know, it breaks my heart to think that even with my brother or, you know, close people, that this, it could just be you. And it's very difficult because just think, right? Like, you go home, I went home for Christmas, for example, and, you know, it's very, like, a warm time, like, all of your relatives are there. And, of course, you're not thinking, like, oh, man, like, you know, when this all ends, like, it's just going to be me. But, you know, there are moments when you're at home, and as a convert, you have to, you know, there's just certain things, if there's certain things as a Muslim community, you just kind of take as norms, right? Like, we're not going to have dogs in the house, like, we're not going to do this. But for some reason, like, when I came home for Thanksgiving, and then, like, again for Christmas, my mom had two dogs and my brother had a dog, and I was like, great. So, I mean, they're cute, you know, and, like, someone gave a khutbah recently that talked about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, like, protecting puppies, and I was like, okay, so, you know, they're not as bad, okay, like, I'm normally, like, a fish person, like, I can deal with fish, okay? So, anyway, like, my brother let the dog in my room. I was like, come on, guys, like, my room is the one place, like, no pets. So, he let the dog in there, and, you know, did its business, and I felt so violated, and no one understood fiqh. Like, how do you explain, you know, they love their dogs, like, that's their best friend, and they treat them like they're my siblings or something. How do you explain fiqh to them, and they're like, oh, Whitney, that's just like Islam or something, and I'm so offended, and I felt very isolated, especially being in a part of the country where there's no subway for me to just, like, jump on a train and, like, you know, take a breather, you know. So just be grateful that, you know, you have this kind of safe space at home. You have people who, like, who love you dearly, who are praying for you, and who you could possibly spend eternity with. Like, that's so precious, you know.
Sorry, I just, really quick before Lisa goes, I mean, the last two speakers said something that's really important, and I want to chime in as a non-convert on this. think about all of that, and then think about what it feels like when they're told, you can't marry my son or daughter because you're not from our country. And you want to conceptualize this, because people are not one-dimensional, they have many layers. And they come with their experiences, they come with their emotions, and the way you treat them is going to have a big impact on how they react to you and how they move forward in their lives. And so two of your brothers and sisters right now just said to you, it's hard for us to deal with the fact that our family is not Muslim. And then if you say to them, well, we understand, but you can't be a part of our family because of something nobody really asked you about in the first place in terms of who your parents were or where you would be born into the world, what do you think it's going to make them feel like? So don't do that. Like, for real. Don't do it. Because it hurts. And hurting people is haram. Like, seriously. And you want to think about it like that. You don't have to be a convert to be a baby in your Islam. And many non-converts are babies in their Islam too. And it starts from the way we treat one another. So think about it.
I would just say, I think something that people who are raised in a Muslim family take for granted is that you have the freedom and the ability to express your Islam like the way you want to. You know, if you're a brother and you have like a long beard, mashallah, like nobody's gonna, if you walk into your house, nobody's gonna say, you know, chop that thing off or shave it off. If you're a sister and you choose to wear hijab, you know, inshallah, nobody's telling you, you know, take it off, don't wear it. Whereas, you know, hijab is very important to me and I love wearing it, but when I go home, I take it off because I don't want my mother to start crying again because I'm wearing it and that I'm doing something that is upsetting her. And so I'm trying to, you know, inshallah, find like a balance where I can potentially make this work and still be expressing my Islam the way I want to without making my mother upset, because that is also something that makes me upset. And so the fact that you have the ability to do that, I think, is something that a lot of Muslims take for granted. And, you know, inshallah, may Allah make it easy for us to express our Islam the way we want to.
Marlene.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm also a convert from Chile, so I wasn't raised here. And thank you. And one thing that nobody touched upon is learning Arabic. We pray in Arabic, and we have to memorize the surahs in Arabic. And nobody has taught me Arabic. So I think we need to have somebody to help us with that. Alhamdulillah, I have a friend who taught me, I know, about 6 surahs or 7 that I memorized, and he taught me over the phone. He would repeat it and repeat it and repeat it, and I wrote it in half Spanish, half English, whatever it sounded to me, kind of like, and that's how I memorized it. But it's really hard, and I would love to speak Arabic. And sometimes I hear that some Muslims that speak Arabic and can read it haven't memorized any surahs. Astaghfirullah. And the last thing is, when we have a khutbah and the imams speak Arabic terms, sometimes they skip and they don't explain it. And I'm just hanging like a light bulb. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
So, Maryam, and the sister, I'm sorry, sister, I don't know your name. I apologize. Sarah. Nazira.
Nasira.
Nasira. So, yeah.
Questions. First, Imam Sahib, you had said something about African-American brothers facing a lot of discrimination, so I was just wondering why you specified brothers instead of just saying in general. And then my second question was that there are 3 women on the panel, but I think that Overall, it's actually the majority of converts are women. I don't know if like we know that for sure. So I was just wondering, and obviously like the gender dynamics in the Muslim community can be interesting to say the least. So I'm just wondering if like you guys can comment on what that's been like.
First and foremost, actually, I served as an imam on the African American community in St. Louis about 13 years ago. And then moving to California, a number of brothers who live actually, if you can believe it, in Silicon Valley, right? Who would think that people in Silicon Valley would have these kind of issues as Muslims? So constantly running into my brothers who have been turned away, have been actually told to their face it's because they're black, or basically, I remember actually I forced a marriage in my community between a Pakistani girl and an African-American brother. And when I went to meet her father, it was like a Freudian slip. The first thing he's told to me is, I'm not a racist, I don't have any racial problems, but no. And then, you know, talking to him and seeing it as a constant, especially amongst the brothers who are African American, that was my experiences. And working in a community also that was predominantly African American. And I had a brother last year, a very, very gifted brother. He works actually for like Facebook. He's making six figures. He's a Stanford graduate from the west side of Chicago. He came into my office and he dresses, you know, he dresses like he's an urban Bedouin, right? So he has the urban gear. And he was like, he just stopped right in front of my door. And I was like, you know, wow, who's his brother, right? And he was like, Imam. He said, am I haram? And I was like, are you haram? Like, what do you mean? He said, like, no, am I haram? He's serious. Like, it's funny, but it's really, I mean, like Khaled is saying, man, words carry weight, man. Like, when people bash Kufar and your parents are Kufar and your brothers are Kufar and your uncles are Kufar, my mother gives money to Muslim organizations, man. Mm. Don't tell me that my mother is like some crazy Pharaonic kafir. You know, my mother, when I graduated from Ezhar, she's like, my son went to the oldest university in the world. I mean, you know, like, it's not, these things hurt us. I think it's good to have, like, she says, almost therapeutic when you're hearing people just destroying non-Muslims. But I have family members, like, my mother used to wake me up for Fajr, man. Mm-hmm. I was an imam once and I missed Fajr, and I tried to, like, not let her hear it. And she was like, what type of imam are you? And then I said to her, what type of creation of Allah are you? You worship more than one God. She's like, I don't hear it. But I think sometimes we don't understand that our words, like I appreciate what a brother earlier said, it threw you off for like 3 years. Just words, right? Kalima Sayya is like Shajara Sayya. So that brother was in my doorway and he was just distraught. And this is a graduate from Stanford. This is not somebody that's not got it up here, got it together. He's like, I'm going back to the west side of Chicago to start like NGOs to help the community. I mean, he's not a dumb guy. He's asking me, am I haram? So I was like, you're not haram, you're Adami, you know, you're a human being. He said, well, whenever I go to the mosque, people tell me that I'm haram because of how I dress. And he was like, I don't really feel that it's an issue of how I dress, but it's more an issue of my color. So my experience has been with that predominantly.
I also wanted to say that from my perspective, I thought converting to Islam was like a revolutionary act. And I mean, you know, I felt like the Prophet's example was to like abolish racism, right? To abolish that as like a primary factor, like tribalism or like case, like all these different ways that we see it expressed in society. And especially like as an African-American woman, I felt like, you know, I could never be Jewish because I felt like they're our brothers, but I felt like I couldn't be Jewish because they're too separate. Like something about them has never been inclusive in my life as an African-American woman. Christianity and Catholicism, for example, I didn't want images, and I thought, you know, Islam just made sense because it was just acknowledging that there's one God, and I just thought the Prophet's example was revolutionary. So to see like Muslims who are so like tribalistic or who can't like think for themselves, it drives me nuts. And I think also just the experience of African Americans in this country, I just have like, I embrace my heritage fully, and I just think that it's everyone who's in this country's heritage to just not accept racism. It's just really, it disgusts me. So I hope that, you know, inshallah, I don't mean to be so negative about it, but it's just not, it's just not nice, you know? Racism is just, it's a form of arrogance. And we know that, like, arrogance is like following shaitan. So I just really think people should be very careful about, you know, how they prioritize, you know, who they associate with or, you know, who they marry. Like, I just think that's really dangerous. And we have a revolutionary example in the Prophet to oppose this, you know.
So we're gonna make these two questions the last two questions because we went over by a lot.
Khalid, can I answer the girl question?
Sure, girl.
All right, cool. So I think that's a wonderful question, and then there's many, and the one that I want to focus on actually is when I, growing up, I was always pushed up to be a leader, always pushed up. I was always told that I could, you know, stand up in front of a crowd and speak my mind. And that was, you know, alhamdulillah, that's like something that's like just this amazing thing that I was pushed. And not to say, I mean, the people that I was around, alhamdulillah, they pushed, when I became Muslim, they pushed me to be a leader as well. But it's like, I felt like it wasn't always allowed for me to be a leader in the faith. Like, I mean, but from what I could see in the text, like I have this text in front of me, like it says, the believers, both men and women, are in charge and responsible for one another. They enjoin the doing of what is right and forbid in what is doing wrong. That says, like, right there, you know, it's Surah, sorry, 9, verse 71, like that we all have the ability to be leaders. And so, like, I want to give you a modern cultural context to all the women that are out there. A little bit of Madonna, okay? So don't just stand there, just get to it. Strike a pose, there's nothing to it.
So on these last two questions, I'm really sorry, but if we keep the responses, like, not... Yeah, just go ahead. Do what you gotta do.
Hi. Assalamu alaikum. I just really want to tell you, speaking as a convert now, 2 years, just saying that I want to emphasize to you that I know that you've lost many a people that you were used to dealing with. And it is not easy in any way, shape, or form to lose the people whom you have had ties to. With that being said, how have you guys, although with the brother on the third, with the long beard, I'm sorry, I can't see your name. although you had said poignantly, Allah removed the bad and replaced it with even better, how is it that you individually, and please keep your answer short, individually have accepted this, and although with the trials, how have you dealt with even your own family disowning you, or your friends leaving you, or your how have you handled the grasp of the change? How have you handled it, and how has it empowered you to treat your fellow converts or non-converts? How do you treat them now, having being armed with this information and power on how people have perceived you as converts, as new Muslims? How have you dealt with the separation of what you were used to? How have you dealt with it in the way Islamically? That's all. That was my question.
I don't know if that made sense. You got that? Y'all got that? Y'all got that? Y'all good? We clear? All right, good.
To answer the question, I would just remind myself and my fellow panelists and all of us just to maintain the proper protocol referring to Islamic character. As we know, when our mother Aisha was asked, what was the Prophet like? She said his character was the Quran. So, and we see slew of examples of how the Prophet dealt with people in the best of manners, even when they oppressed him. Like, we know the example of the person who would throw trash at his doorway, and he went to visit this person on their deathbed, and he asked, where is my gift? Right? So slew of examples. Even if a person, like, does you dirty in a sense, or, like, cuts you off, as a Muslim, we still have an obligation to do what I said earlier, is that what the Prophet said, that the Muslim is one who protects people from their negative statements and their negative actions. We're not going to be held accountable for other people's negative statements and actions. We're going to be held accountable for our own. So as long as we come correct based upon the book and the wisdom, that's all that matters. And Allah will bring people to us, and Allah will remove negative from us.
So Peter, and then Zinga will have the next question, and then we'll wrap up.
I just wanted to add something really quickly. You know, like, I know, Khalid, and I kind of, we've all been talking about, like, very extreme difficulties and you know, people losing all their friends, being disowned or you know, by their families. And I just wanted to just stress this, that, you know, it's not always something that big. And don't just look, you know, as non-converts, I guess, don't just look for big things like that. Like, you know, don't assume, oh, well, this brother, this sister converted to Islam and they didn't get kicked out of their house, so they're fine. You know, it's really, like we said earlier, it's very lonely. You know, before I, you know, got to college and, like, had Muslims around, you know, shout out to QC in the house. Yeah, they're here. You know, there weren't people around. So, you know, just be aware of that. I mean, you know, I don't know how many converts are here today. Like, could you guys raise your hands if you're a convert? It's a lot of people. MashaAllah. So, yeah, definitely. Just try to just keep an eye out for people, you know, and because it's not always the big things. I know that wasn't, like, the main part of the question, but it's not always the big things. A lot of times it's the little things that can be the most, you know, difficult. So,
So I have a question about, you know, sometimes, I guess, and you guys have mentioned this, when people become Muslim, like convert to Islam, then you feel like this weight is lifted and you feel like things are so perfect. And I feel like sometimes with converts, and I have this experience with a friend, then it's like you get on this high and it lasts for, I don't know, it could be several months to a year, and then you realize that you still have yourself to deal with and Islam has not erased all of your problems, you know, or just, which maybe just general problems that people have, like, you know, that you still have to deal with the world. And then for some people, then it becomes like, maybe they feel let down by this experience that they've had. And I have a question, because, like, I have, you know, a friend and who kind of had this experience of converting to Islam, and then I think she was on this high, you know, and I, you know, we were friends before she was Muslim, and then I think she came to a point where whatever happened, I think she was in a relationship and that let her down, and so she suddenly, you know, she stopped practicing, but nonetheless she's like disconnected from me, and I feel like maybe she may be in that point where, you know, where maybe she feels like she's not living up to the standard of being Muslim. But, you know, like, how can a Muslim friend help that friend who is in the position where now they just have to deal with the reality of their life and the fact that they may not be doing everything that's correct, and they may be going back to that lifestyle, but you're still trying to be the supportive friend who's like, well, you can still connect with me, you can still be my friend, but you don't want to make them have to be a certain way. Like, how can the friend help you guys?
That's the longest question in the world, man.
I'm sorry.
Hey, what are you doing?
How to be a friend to converts who have
what I say is, don't give up on your friend.
Right.
Hang out with her. Take her to the masjid. Just keep her in that environment. Because if you leave her alone and she goes astray, she starts thinking her own thoughts, she'll, you know, you got to just keep her around good people. And as long as they're around that, they'll continue. We feed off each other, you know? And I think that's more important.
Yeah. Does anybody want to answer really quick?
I'll just say one thing is just, you know, kind of reiterate, and, you know, you did say, like, don't put pressure on people. I remember, after I became Muslim, after a couple of years, like, I didn't really go to my masjid. I was a local masjid, mashallah. I'm not saying anything negative about them. You know, it was, alhamdulillah, great that it was very close to me, but it was a lot of older people, a lot of like uncles and stuff, and it was, you know, it was a mainly Pakistani masjid, a lot of things were in Urdu, and I didn't really have a connection there. It wasn't, you know, I loved the deen, but I just didn't feel a connection there. But I had a friend who called me and be like, yo man, you gotta come to the masjid. And I'm like, I'm sleeping, like you didn't even, it's 8 a.m, I didn't know there was anything going on. Come on man, what kind of Muslim are you? Gotta, you know, that you don't want to do stuff like that. And mashallah, he's a great friend, but you know, nobody's perfect, right? So you know, those type of things, because Muslims, you know, as Muslims, we really need people who we could just, like you said, we could talk to, because you know, we're a lot of times we're struggling with getting it right, and not just that, but you know, like we said, about family, and we have a lot of things that we're upset about or concerned about and on our mind, and you know, just be someone that they can talk to, you know, like, I mean, you know, we were talking about family before, I you know, and worrying about, you know, the final destination for our parents and our siblings and stuff, and you know, I we all go through that, and I try to block it out sometimes, but you know, you get upset. And I remember one day I was you know, kind of like, it was really late at night, and I was like in my room, I was crying, you know, I was praying and making dua and crying about this. And my sister had, I guess she came home late, and she, I'm not, you know, I'm trying to say anything bad about my sister, but she came home late, she was in the other room, and I guess she heard me. I went out to come out to go to the bathroom, she's like, what are you crying about? So I was like, I don't want to tell you, because I know she's I was crying about, you know, like, are they gonna be in the, you know, in the nar, in the fire? So I'm just like, I don't know if I want to tell you. She's like, no, come on, tell me. And I'm like, I was worried. I'm crying because I'm worried about you and mom and dad, and you know where you're gonna end up. And she got mad at me. She's like, can't believe you. Oh my God, this is what you're crying about. You're so stupid. Oh my God. And I was like crying. Like, how can you? You know. So it's like sometimes you don't have anyone to talk to. You know, like even and mashallah, my sister, you know, really great. You know, she's always there for me and stuff. But that was something she couldn't relate to me on that. You know, she was just, it's just totally weird for her. So it's very important to be someone that, you know, you can be a resource to that person, to talk, just to talk to them, and that you know that Islam, and so you know what how they're feeling about a lot of these things. Inshallah.
So really, really, yeah, man. Go ahead.
It'll take 30 seconds.
I can't tell him not right. It's a convert panel. I'm gonna tell a convert to shut up, right? Then I'm just gonna look really hypocritical, you know? So, right?
Inshallah, it'll be worth it.
No, I'm just joking. Please take your time.
So to answer your question, it's general advice, but it's simple advice, and I would say that your friend's pain and confusion are real and ought to be recognized and validated, as any sort of pain, you know. Pain that is suppressed doesn't go away. It just manifests itself in other ways. And that's all I'll say about that. In light of your question, the fact that you're trying to help your friend, I just wanted to recognize that you're trying. I recently had the pleasure of sitting in on a lecture with Sheikh Faraz Rabbani, may Allah preserve him, and he said that the prophetic attitude is essentially, and I'm humbly paraphrasing what he said, is essentially that 95% of the people in this world are really trying their best, and they don't really mean any harm to anyone. So I just wanted to acknowledge the fact that you're all trying your best, and we're going through something. You're all going through your own things, but inshallah, this should unite us as a community. And that's all.
As we wrap up this session, I apologize that it went over. I'm pretty sure, alhamdulillah, that everyone benefited from it. And one of the things that we want to focus on, aside from the primary content,